Live and Learn. Welcome to Season 2 of our weekly conversations about living, learning, teaching, and intercultural communication. We discuss cultural awareness and diversity, education and mentality, and we never really know where our talk will bring us in each episode. So, we just follow our curiosity and invite you to join us.
I think we are reinventing this one step at a time.
We're on this way, we're doing it together. I'm learning, I'm showing how I learn. I'm happy when you are learning with me.
We understand by the notion of a student, an adult who is able to make their own choices and is able to have the responsibility for their own choices.
My course, my teacher, am I completely present? Am I getting what I am there for?
My task as a teacher is to create the environment where they want to come, where they feel safe to come, and where they can catch up with everything that they missed.
So it's another week of living and learning.
Happy new week, happy new week. I'm super happy to come back to teaching class. We were allowed to teach at the university, lecturing to real people, to real eyes, to in real time, with people breathing and living and learning at the same time, was a fantastic experience for me. I got really impressed and excited and inspired, I need to say.
Well, for me, coming back in an offline classroom is a pretty weird piece of experience because I'm so much used to teaching online. I think we already said about it. I've been teaching online since 2013, from time to time, since 2015, constantly and exclusively online. That's why coming back into a real classroom, I wouldn't call it a real classroom, rather an offline classroom, because an online one is a real classroom for me. Being present in the same place, in the same room with other people is kind of weird, and I need more preparation in terms of being tuned to people, being tuned to different moods. For me, it's more energy consuming now to teach offline than online, which I'm more used to.
I think those are always individual experience depending on a number of factors, including what the group, if you're teaching individually or giving a lecture to a group. Again, if this is a workshop or a webinar or colloquium or a lecture. So yesterday I had 4 lectures at the university with 2 groups. I got really inspired and everybody was so happy to have real life interaction. I need to say that the reactions are much quicker and I'm able to lead and see if students follow, and I'm able to delegate the lead to those students who I want to speak up, and those who try to find an example to a specific part of the lecture. So basically my lectures become more interactive in reality because of all the experience online, but also much quicker.
Still, with the rules implied now in offline teaching, the distance you have to teach with, you should keep this in mind. If you want to interact, still you should keep in mind that there should be proper distance between all the participants. While it's never an issue in online lessons, when you propose some activities, pair work, group work, you still need to think about how you organize the space around so that you follow the rules. Another thing that makes me feel more comfortable while teaching online is that for me, it's more kind of green because there is no printing out materials. There is never any paper copies, anything. And I'm so much used to this that when I have to bring another copy to a classroom or cut out some pictures or something, I don't feel really good about doing that. I'd rather share my screen or send out a link to a student. Being green, being not so energy consuming, being not so time consuming in terms of commuting, preparation, etc., makes online teaching more convenient for me and more familiar as the way of delivering information and organizing interactive activities, sending out links, sharing all kinds of information in a green way. Getting back to an offline classroom provokes these thoughts about how am I going to organize this stuff now that I'm so much used to being green in my lessons.
Yeah, I totally agree here. The thing is that with the technology being a part of the class and a simple way of, I don't know, using a projector for me helped so much to get people focused on the wall. It's like not necessarily it is a whiteboard, the interactive whiteboard, though there are the cases which that was a great piece of equipment, but even a projector on a white wall brings all the interactivity and brings all the green part into the class, because I normally do the interactive lectures where every picture is redirecting you to the site, to the article, to the extra material. So basically the students get really quickly used to the idea that every slide gets another layer, gets another piece of material that it's up to them, or I direct them to go there compulsory or maybe not. It's always a nice thing to remember that if you print out those slides, you're losing so much of the meta information and so many links and so on. So in the end, it becomes, I wouldn't say useless, you still can get a rough idea what's happening, but it gets a lot of layers more shallow. I think what's missing in the teaching in the classroom is the kind of chat box with all the students where I can highlight or I can send a link or something like this in the chat box and everybody's sure to see it, because in the lectures we have the platform where I can upload my PPT files, for example, but not necessarily I can communicate with all the group. While, for example, teaching in MS Teams, I always have the communication, direct communication with all the participants. I can do a poll quickly to ask, is everybody in the city? And we can actually arrange the on-site class, or like how many people are going to be present online in Berlin and offline in Berlin. So basically we have three different types of student location for the hybrid learning. And next week I will need to come to the classroom knowing that most of the students will be online. Another weird thing for me, which I'm only getting used to, is when you see that there were a number of students signed for your class. So for example, last week I had 67 people signed for the class and it got me like scared. How am I going to organize the classes everybody comes? I don't want to do a lecture when I teach everybody. I do want the activities, I do want the collaboration, I do want communication, but then I don't know how many will be there, what kind of the network will be there, if they have a stable internet or not. And the students who came last week were from, I don't know, 15 different countries, including Bulgaria, Bangladesh, South Korea, Afghanistan, US, New Zealand, Poland, Armenia. And for them, they were, it was, the time zone becomes an issue. Because in India, people were having my class at 11 p.m. Of course, it's difficult to get the time span of 4 hours class when it is 11 p.m. In your time zone. So we have completely different range of the questions that we're all dealing with, and we need to find the question, the answers to those questions, at least to voice them.
I also have a lot of curious feedback from students, high school students, who started this academic year, this school year, with already a hybrid form of education. So they have some lessons in an offline classroom and some lessons online because they cannot be connected to other people studying in another class, and still they have got optional subjects in which they theoretically would be mixed. In order to avoid that, a school proposes that part of a class is in a live classroom and another part is following online, in order not to be mixed with other students who you normally don't study in the same class with. And that's for epidemic reasons, that's clear. At the same time, it arises more questions. Aren't these students who have to follow online, don't they feel that it's their disadvantage in this form of learning, especially if it's a language lesson? Why wouldn't they have this chance to collaborate in a classroom with other students and participate in communicative activities? Why are they just following online? What is going on in an offline classroom? And then one of the questions that arises here for me is how to organize this process in a communicative way equally for everyone. Then, of course, my question to the management would be, why don't you think about this equality and equal opportunities for all the students? Why do you put some of them initially in a position of disadvantage compared to others?
That's a question if they are in position of disadvantage. And this is a question to each and every university management, because the ones that I collaborate with, they are thinking about it every day. And I have a product manager in the university who is creating, who is sharing with the teachers how we can get people to be a part of the collaboration, to be a part of the polls, to be part of the answers, to the, I don't know, they are creating endless Kahoots, murals, everything so that everybody is collaborating. Another thing is that what they ask the students to do is to bring their mobile devices or laptops to the class offline as well, so that everybody is in a virtual environment, collaborating all together. And the screen goes on the wall, projecting what's happening in virtual environment, just like we happen to be in the same place with some of the students offline as well. So it's not like I'm teaching only the offline students, I'm teaching the virtual environment, like everybody who's in the MS Teams, for example, and some of them happen to be in the same room. So it would be my task to think how to attribute them to the breakout rooms or smaller channels so that somebody here in the classroom would be connected with other students virtually. But what I find here is the biggest disadvantage is not the idea that someone's online, somebody's offline, but somebody is in line and somebody is out of line. I cannot know if the students who are not switching on their videos and cameras are actually there and are actually acquiring the knowledge or participating. All I can see is the avatar with ABC written on their avatar, not even the face. I don't even know some of these students' faces because they've never switched the camera on. So basically it's like I'm talking to the wall, and I'm really, really happy and thankful when there are some people who are empathetic enough to understand that when I'm asking a question, I need the answer so that I have this communication happening. So in such classes, most of time, there happen to be more empathetic students that, you know, keep on answering me and cutting this time for pinging here and back, here and back. And it's difficult to make it communicative when you have, I don't know, more than 4, 5, 10 people. So when you have 30 people, suddenly it becomes a question, how do they answer? So they unmute yourself, but then they speak in one over another, and it becomes a mess when nobody understands what was told. Right? But again, saying that now you say, now you say, now you have the right to say is not, again, the teaching method that we are get used to. I think we are reinventing this one step at a time, one experience at a time. And we have the sync ups with the product manager saying, what was the problem? What was something that, what can I do with this? So for example, in MS Teams, there is always this problem of switching between the screens. So when I'm showing my presentation and I want, for example, to click on a link, so the link opens in the browser, so I need to unscreen myself, unshare my screen, then switch on the screen and then start sharing again. And if you have like 60 people online, it takes time. It becomes an awkward pause. It takes time to understand how to optimize and how to make this time more efficient. So for example, when I'm teaching the first time, most probably that wouldn't be evident, but the second, the third, the fourth time, I understand that it's better not to share my presentation, but to open the presentation in the browser and share the browser with only that tab open. And then when the link opens, so you share the whole browser so you can jump from one to another. But you need experience, but you need to have this lesson, you need to have this painful moment when you couldn't do this, and then coming up with what can I do with this specific situation. There are so many things that we haven't tried, and therefore we're learning at the same time as we're teaching.
Which is completely about having growth mindset. It's a very good example to our students as well. When we come to a classroom or we have a class and our students can see that we cannot do something in the beginning, but then we are learning and then we master this skill. It's also part of teaching if we want to share this part of our teacher's identity as a teacher who's constantly learning. Giving this example to the students as well, guys, in the beginning of your way somewhere, you might not be skillful. It's okay. What is not okay is not to acquire new knowledge and skills. Not knowing, not being able to do something in the beginning is completely okay. We're on this way, we're doing it together. I'm learning, I'm showing how I learn. I'm happy when you are learning with me. I'm happy when together we go in some direction and reach our goals.
And then suddenly you get feedback from the students that this semester is much easier than the previous. Okay, everybody was in such a shock in March, when everybody got to start learning and teaching online. Okay, I may have had quite a bulk of experience of online learning before, but that was one-to-one individual learning, or for example, learning through Skype. And when I'm putting my students into the new environment, for me, I'm learning as much in this new environment. And I'm sorry, Google and Microsoft have extraordinarily different interfaces. And for me, the biggest problem was that two of the universities I teach for are using Google and their own platforms, which are in other interfaces. I need to understand how to use and operate them. And they are complicated. They are not easy and super intuitive. They are bulky and complex, and they are complicated, and they are in German. I beg your pardon. And two other universities are using MS Teams, which is a completely new environment for me. I've never been a Microsoft Office user before. So even another range of the tabs, or another range of the where I can find how to count the words number, I have no idea where to find it in Microsoft Office. So that is, I don't know, doesn't put me to the skilled professional. Or is it? Or is it not? We're still learning. Everybody's learning.
I personally find it just beautiful. And during one semester, you learned how to use a range of different platforms. You improved your German skills. You showed your students that as a teacher, you're also learning. And this is a big, great lesson.
For those who appreciate. For those who lives and learns.
Those who don't appreciate are not your target audience.
Well, sometimes I do not choose my audience. Sometimes they choose me.
You deliver your lessons to your target audience anyway, who is not, those who are not your target audience don't perceive, don't appreciate. So what?
So not all the students in the list are getting their knowledge they came for.
They get the knowledge they came for. This is the key to me. From you or not from you, or from another teacher who is their teacher. And your students who are your target audience get knowledge from you as their teacher. That's why I would be calm and confident about that. You teach your students. Your students learn from you. Those who do not acquire the knowledge in your course are not your students, even if they're enrolled in the list of your of the students of your course.
It's soothing feeling to hear that. Again, this is a soothing feeling to understand that all the people who are, I don't know, 97 or 67 people who are assigned for my class or who are waiting for my class, it's not necessarily that they are all coming. This is another scope that might be interesting to discuss, that this FOMO, fear of missing out. I'm, again, the person who is, when I'm learning, they see the opportunity, I sign up, and I sign up for the events, I sign up for the conferences. And then I try to understand if I'm making it to come or not. And that gives me this thing to allow students to decide if they want to be present here and now, to be a part of this learning environment, this learning experience.
Before I sign up for a course, a webinar, an event, I first check my agenda and see if I can make it. If I can, I sign up and then most probably participate. If nothing else appears, and usually nothing else appears because when I sign up, I put it on my agenda.
I am doing a completely different way. I can sign up for everything that interests me. And I end up having 2, 3, 5, 7 events in the evening planned for me. where I already signed up, and then I decide which one I have the mood for, which I have the time for, if I'm too tired after the day of lectures, if I'm not. If then logistic decided before Corona, how much time do I need to get somewhere? Or if this is on my road, on my way. So basically I have completely different factors deciding if I'm making to the event or to the conference or to the gathering anytime. But this leaves me the opportunity to seize this opportunity, you know, to get much more value, much more appreciation when I'm actually getting there and I'm enjoying this and I'm getting satisfaction from this learning or this participation.
And then do you feel better about your FOMO?
That's a good question. Then I understand that I took all the opportunities I could have taken, and then it is up to me to decide either I'm grabbing it or not in the moment. So basically that helps me to live in the moment when I need to make a decision. Imagine a normal day and 6 o'clock now, and I have like 6 notifications of what awaits for me. One is jazz, one is wine tasting, one is the lecture on poetry, one is the lecture on psychotherapy, two are the, I don't know, coding event and HR events, and one is a, somebody said that they are open for a online wine, glass of wine. Well, I have no idea how tired will I be by the end of the day. I have no idea either will I want to participate, to choose one at this moment, which calls for me, or do I want just to put the music on and, I don't know, dance with my husband. That's something that helps my fear of missing out, is opportunity to make a decision in flow, right now, what's better for me at this moment. When I'm signing for the event, because I understand that this is in the field of my interests, this is something that I want to be notified about, this is something that I want to be able not to miss when I'm making decision where to go. So I understand that the event makers will probably hate me because that means that I'm not coming to 6 out of 7 events because I need to choose. But I think this is becoming a more and more new normality issue, and everybody who's creating the events understand that if 300 people signed up, that most probably you will have 25.
That's also a good point to feel what your students feel in the lessons. Yeah, because if you've got this experience of signing up for something, then feeling tired maybe, or losing your interest in the process, or having some other tasks or worries, having this experience, you can understand your students better and maybe stop feeling bad about not being enough as a teacher for those students who you feel are not participating as actively as you expect them to.
I don't know. Maybe. Okay, I will tell you what it helps with. Bologna process, Bologna's document helps here, because it says that one of the grounding fundamental things that we all signed was the Bologna process, the university rule of conduct, all European, is that we understand by the notion of a student, an adult who is able to make their own choices and is able to have the responsibility for their own choices. One of the lines of this Bologna document, which we had as a, you know, we were studying as a constitution, I guess, back in 2007, 2008, in my Masters of Higher Education, program says that you need to understand that these are adult students, university level students, and they can be ill, they can be out of scope, they can come, they cannot come. It's up to them to decide, and you need to give them this right to decide and to act accordingly. If they missed the class, that's their responsibility. If they didn't get the materials from the class that they missed, it's their responsibility. My task as a teacher is to create the environment where they want to come, where they feel safe to come, and where they can catch up with everything that they missed. Since that time, I've been telling all my students that, yes, it's okay. I don't actually really need not to care what was the reason why I didn't come. I take you as a person who is able to decide to come or not to come. And this strikes, you know, really surprising to the students. What do you mean? No, I can be empathetic to you personally to actually know what happened, but I don't need to. Legally, it's not my scope of necessary knowledge that I need to know why you didn't come. It's completely and totally the responsibility of the students.
I also mean that even when students are present and they come to a lesson and still are not participating as actively as you expect them to, as a teacher who provides for the environment, who organizes all the activities, and still sees an avatar instead of a photo or a video of a student, or in an offline classroom, just sees that a person is doing something else and is not actively participating in the activities offered. As a person who has also got this experience of signing up for courses and then having your personal choice and mood and level of energy at the time of the lesson, you can also be empathetic with students better than if you didn't have that experience. Making decisions about your own curriculum also, yeah, like if we get back to high school, for instance, where the students have their first experience of making decisions on their curriculum. And they've got some classes that they all attend, and then they've got this choice of some optional subjects they choose from, they sign up to. During this weird school year, they sometimes find themselves following these optional subjects online while other students are in an offline classroom, which also adds up a bit to new experience of getting the knowledge of following your curriculum in this or that way. So that's the first experience, the first steps in creating your own curriculum. You make your choice. You sign up, you participate, or you do not. Then when students come to universities and again, there is this point of my course, my teacher, am I completely present? Am I getting what I am there for? Another yet level is that private area. When I sign up for courses that are not part of my curriculum at university or at school, but that I choose to take because I'm interested, because I'm curious, because it's part of my personal or professional interest. Do you believe we invest equally when we choose these courses at a level of a high school, university, and private courses? Invest our money, attention, presence, energy, is it the same? Or is it different depending on a type of a course of education?
I think this is, again, the very same thing as seeing the bigger picture and understanding your responsibility to make the choice. Again, if we're talking about Bologna system, Bologna document, you can participate, you can choose to participate, you can choose not to come to the class and still bring your document, your examination, and not to be failed for not being there. So you always have this opportunity or the proportion of kind of the assignments that you need to hand in. Or you can as well choose not to hand in your examination paper and just to lose all the time that you invested before. So which looks weird and absolutely mind-blown to me. But anyway, this is something that we leave as a respectful choice to the student. So, for example, a student can follow the course and then he understands or she understands that they are not ready to submit a academic paper, or they are not time-wise prepared to submit it. Or like I heard another way of putting it, I decided that I do need a vacation after such a stressful period that it was my choice to go to the vacation. I understood that I just won't hand in the paper. So the person doesn't have the credits for the course that he followed, and I don't know, half of this was ready. But in the end, that was his choice. And if he is clear in the point of making choice that it is more important to me to get a good vacation right now, because otherwise I would be out of the order, and then it's a clear point of responsibility, then he's not getting the credits. Yesterday when I was talking to such a person, he wasn't disappointed or distracted by this. He was sad that he missed the opportunity. He says that from this point, if looking back, it would be wiser, I didn't know, to actually pass the test. But he said that still, he understands that his choice was right because he badly needed the vacation because he was too tired. This expands my understanding why some students are not bringing their examination paper or like final papers, because I tend to think that something was not right from my side. But sometimes people just need to be left the opportunity to make their choices consciously. This happens as well.
Yeah, that's a cool point about being responsible as a student for your way in learning, for, as said before, right, for creating your own curriculum and then making a responsible decision about whether you finish the course, whether you hand in the paper, whether you get the points or not. Yeah, you can base your choice on anything. Your personal reasons, your health, your wishes, maybe you changed your mind in general, but it's your responsibility.
And I respect this choice. The funny thing that I asked, what, 3-4 months later, what happened? Just purely from the empathetic point of view, like, was everything right? And then when I heard the explanation, I said, well, okay, then at least you knew that that would be a priority. At least you're able to make a priority, because what we're learning in the university sometimes is not only the content, but also time management, self-management, process management, product management. Those are, again, the transferable skills and a lesson that this person definitely will learn, that prioritizing does have its price. Yeah, but then you don't need to be guilty that you badly needed the vacation. Maybe you need a bunch of other things how not to get yourself to the point when you need the vacation that much that you're failing the course. But again, that's a lesson, that's an individual lesson. It's not always in the scope of I want or I don't want. I'm a good student or I'm a lazy student. There's a universe of the reasons, and if we are respectful of this, then there can be a good collaboration and parity. Yes, this is a good thing to live and learn, and learn is not only the subject or a discipline, but also respect, but also time management, self-management, but also so many things that we're happy to live and learn.
Q
curious about what we discuss next? Please subscribe to Live and Learn podcast and join our community on social networks. Live and Learn.